as we go along, I'll tell you what we're pairing with each wine, but then leave some wine in your glass as we go as well so that you can try the other pairings and sort of cross-reference a little bit. And that will, it'll give you an idea of your own preference, what works well, what works second best, what doesn't seem to work well at all, and so on and so forth. No, just wait for her to come in. If she takes a shuttle, so she may be. All right, so the first wine that I gave you is a dry rosé. This is a very classic French dry rosé. It's called Château de Ségouane, and it's from outside of Aix-en-Provence in the south. So as you are right on the border with Italy and the Mediterranean basin, it sort of forms a half moon there. This is right about at 11 or 12 o'clock is the sort of orientation if you're looking at France on a map. Dry rosé is made with red wine grapes, but it's made in the style of a white wine. So they press it and then they draw all of the juice off to ferment it instead of leaving the skins and everything in there, which is what's done with red wine. As a result, you get some of the flavors of red wine. It's a little bit more strongly flavored, but with the texture and the acidity of a white wine. So it goes really well because of that acid with things that have a high fat content. And Food & Wine magazine actually recommended it as a match for grilled cheese sandwiches. So this is a really good, fast, and easy pairing. I made the grilled cheese with just ciabatta bread, which is a very mild sourdough, and then with Comté cheese, which is a mild cheese, but it's a classic French cheese. Hi, LaDonna, how are you? All right, so we've got your seat right here for you. Taylor's gonna help you out, and I'm gonna put your grilled cheese right here.
Okay.
For you.
Yep.
Oh no.
Oh no, not.
But you've seen him before.
Right. I know what Halloween is.
So give that a try. Give the wine a little swirl. Smell it. Give it a taste, and then after you've tasted the wine, try the food, and then try the wine again. It should taste different after you've had food than when you're just drinking it on its own. It's a good way to start a Saturday with a little grilled cheese with butter, right?
Yes.
So the tricks with food and wine pairing, a lot of people when they think about wine and choose wine, they talk about flavors. What are the flavors like? Do the flavors match the flavors in food and so forth? And that's important to a degree, but a lot of what you're pairing as well is texture and density. How rich is the wine? How much does it coat your mouth? If you think about the difference between drinking skim milk, 2% milk, whole milk, half and half, heavy cream. If you've ever run out of milk in the house, I do it every Thanksgiving. I use up all the milk, and then the next day when I have coffee, I end up putting heavy cream in it because that's all I have in the refrigerator. And it doesn't taste weird because the texture is so different if you're not used to it. So it's the same thing with wines. Dry rosé is gonna have a light texture. It's not really mouth coating, but it's got a lot of acidity. You get it in the back teeth a lot.
Okay.
And when you pair that high acid with something with a lot of fat, it cuts through the fat and it kind of cleans it off your palate. So whenever you think about eating something that's really greasy or really oily or really fatty, like fried chicken, for example, or a pork tenderloin that's got a lot of fat on it, or even barbecue, having a wine with a lot of acidity is going to just clean all of that fat right off your palate. So it's called a pairing of opposites for that reason.
Do you do a rosé or a sparkling
wine. Yep, exactly. So last time we did this class, LaDonna came and we did a sparkling wine. It was actually a sparkling rosé, and it kind of serves the same purpose. Sparkling wines are going to have a lot of acidity. For that reason, sparkling wines, dry rosés as well, and then wines like Tempranillo or Sangiovese that have a lot of acidity in them, are gonna make great universal pairing wines. If you're ever going over to somebody's house for dinner and you say, well, I don't know what they're cooking, but I want to get something that'll go with whatever, those are my first three choices. Sparkling first, if they don't want bubbles, dry rosé. If it's the dead of winter and they don't want dry rosé, then Sangiovese or Tempranillo, so something from Spain or something from Italy. Tasty stuff. We're going to do an Italian that'll sort of fit the same bill as the first of the reds. Exactly. Yep. So some people, if you don't like a high acid wine, if you're in the situation where you're the one cooking and somebody brings you a dry rosé and you don't like really high acid wines, having something fatty with it will cut that acidity and make the flavors come through a little bit more if the acid is shocking to your palate. Yeah.
What was the wine again that you said that began with the T?
Tempranillo. Yep.
It's a Spanish wine.
Yep. And we'll talk about that when we get to this this Italian red that we're going to do as the first of the reds.
Okay.
So the next one I'm going to give you is a dry Riesling. Most Riesling that we have in the States, most Riesling that is imported, especially from Germany, is sweet. So most people, when they think of Riesling, think of a sweet wine. But Riesling, I call it a chameleon varietal because it can be so different depending on where it's from, who's making it, what the soil is like. And this one is bone dry. So it's more like a Sauvignon Blanc or a Pinot Grigio in texture. The flavors are very intense. So give that one a little swirl and a little sniff. Different, huh?
Very different.
What do you smell? Riesling's funny. Sometimes it smells like gasoline. Yeah, I get some of that on there, like petrol. And that's it. It grows best in slate soils or shale. And if you think about where oil comes from, it's usually contained in layers of shale. So you're smelling that oil, that fossil fuel that's trapped in the rock itself. It comes through on the wine as well. But there's also some it's like a gooseberry or some sort of tropical. Yeah, lychee, absolutely. So try that one with the grilled cheese and see how it does. You should get the same sort of textural match. Laura's favorite wines.
This Riesling?
Mm-hmm. She was a big fan.
Now, what is it called?
It's called Jim Berry the Lodge Hill.
It's an Australian Riesling.
So, to pair with this, I made roast chicken with just a white wine butter sauce. So I'm gonna pass it around. We have to do everything family style. Take a couple of chunks of chicken and then I'll pass the sauce and put a spoonful of sauce on the top.
Sure.
Sorry, the sauce is a little, I think I thickened it with too much flour. But the same sort of idea, that you get a lot of richness and sort of creaminess from the sauce. I hope nobody is on a no butter diet because there's about a pound of butter in here. And I have bread over here as well. Here we go. the Riesling, yep. It's good to try it with the rosé as well. It should work. The flavors are a little bit more intense. How is it?
That's good.
So, you know, a lot of times I talk to people who say, I don't really like dry wines, I only like sweet wines. But sweet wines are harder to pair with food. We're going to taste a cream sherry at the very end, and you'll see it's a very sweet style of wine. So do you like it better with the Riesling or the rosé? With the Riesling? It's a little bit richer, a little bit heavier. The rosé is lighter in flavor. The Riesling is very intensely flavored. But they both have that acid backbone. So I would call the Riesling fuller bodied, not full bodied, more medium bodied, but because of that intensity of flavor, it just gives you a little bit more of a punch in the mouth when you're drinking it. Where the rosé is very quaffable, the Riesling is probably, you know, you could finish a bottle. I could finish a bottle. So that's too much better.
I like the Riesling with it better.
Yeah. You like the Riesling with it better?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the grilled cheese where the flavors are a little bit milder. So the trick with food and wine pairing is that you don't want to overwhelm either the food or the wine. If the wine is too weak and the food is too strongly flavored, then it'll end up tasting like water, the wine will. If the wine is too strong and the food is too weak, then it tastes like you're eating sawdust. It just kind of, it shocks your palate too much to be able to appreciate.
What kind of sauce is that for the chicken?
It's a white wine butter sauce. So it's a very simple sauce. You basically just melt butter in the pan. I did it after the chicken was done cooking. And then add in about an equal amount of white wine, and then whisk in a little flour that's been dissolved in cool water, and that thickens it up. So Italian style would be just the wine and the butter with no flour. Adding the flour is more of a French style sauce. It makes the sauce a little bit thicker, and I thought that would probably be less likely to soak my car while I was driving.
Yeah.
It was a logistics call more than a stylist. So the last one I'm going to give you for the whites is an oak barrel fermented Chardonnay. This is from Landers Jenkins. So those of you who were at last week's tasting and tried it, it'll be familiar. So now instead of trying it on its own, we're going to try it with food. This is hers. All right, so the Chardonnay. So again, if you've got a little bit of chicken and sauce left, you can try it with that. I'm going to pass the chicken around again, and this time I'm going to give you a spoonful of a tomato chutney.
Last week.
The wine you tasted. Yes, it's the same Chardonnay that we tasted last week. So this time we're going to go with an opposite, the flavors are still a pairing of opposites, but it's the wine that's creamy and the sauce that's got a little bit more freshness and like herbal characteristics.
It's the white one.
So to make it match in texture, I cooked the sauce with butter. But it's tomato with a little bit of onion. There's a little bit of hot pepper in there, although the cooking takes the heat out of it. And then some cilantro. So take this backwards too. Taste it with the Chardonnay, but then go back and taste it with the Riesling also. Well, God, this is the fall version of the class. For summer, we had all fresh tomatoes and everything. And now we have everything cooked. Thank you. Anybody need a reason again?
You said try to taste this one. Which wine now?
Try it with the Chardonnay, and then go backwards and taste it with the Riesling again as well.
Is your Riesling off here?
So
would you say that the Chardonnay is sweeter than...
No, it's still dry. So technically, the difference between a sweet wine and a dry wine is, does it have any residual sugar in it?
Okay.
If the answer is no, if the fermentation went all the way through, the yeast consumed all the sugar and there's no sugar left, it's a dry wine. It may still taste sweet.
Right.
You may have some jamminess. And the problem with that is that everybody's opinion of what sweet means is different. Some people say, I don't like Chardonnay because it's too sweet. And what they're talking about is the creaminess, that the spice tones, that vanilla and kind of like cinnamon spice from the oak barrel. Some people tell me that Chardonnay is too dry because the oak tannins are coming through and getting them in the back of the palate. Some people tell me Pinot Grigio is too sweet, and then some people tell me that they don't like Pinot Grigio, it's too dry, they want Chardonnay instead because it's sweeter. So what they're talking about for the most part is texture. So here, the Chardonnay was fermented in oak barrels, so it underwent what's called a malolactic conversion. Lactobacillus that live in the oak, the same bacteria that convert milk into yogurt, will convert the malic acid, that green apple acid that's in the grape juice, into lactic acid, which is what you would get in cream or yogurt or cheese. And when that hits your palate interprets it as being milky. If you have a sense memory of that acid being associated with milk and dairy products. So it tastes creamy. Often people will say it smells like butter, sometimes buttered popcorn, or fresh cream, or like ice cream, a vanilla ice cream sometimes. So with the Riesling, you had a high acid. That acidity was mostly malic acid, was the pop that you were getting on the palate. And we paired it with a creamier sauce. For the Chardonnay, you get the creamy element from the wine. So we paired it with a sauce that has butter to match, but has a little bit more freshness in the vegetables.
Hello, how are
you? So what's the verdict? Did you like the tomato chutney better with the Chardonnay or better with the Riesling?
Chardonnay.
I love the Chardonnay with the butter sauce.
With the butter sauce?
Yeah.
And if you want a little more butter sauce, I have it. You can put it on some bread and that'll give you the same sort of element. Yeah, I made the sauce actually with Chardonnay, with oaky Chardonnay that I had at home. So a lot of wines, you know, if we have a bottle that gets half finished, I call it half in the pan wine. You drink half and then the other half goes in. And if you're pairing that wine with that dish, it ends up being a more harmonious pairing because you've got the flavors of the wine already in the food. So that would be a pairing of likes.
Now how about it with the rosé?
Yeah, I can give you, I'm going to give you a little bit more of the sauce. I think the sauce is light enough probably. Now I'll give you some bread. And he needs another dose of rosé. Do you want to try that as well?
Yeah.
So a lot of times with, all right, hold on. I'm going to put the rosé is the one that's further to your left. There you go. Yep. And I'm going to put a piece of bread for you and a little bit of the sauce on top of it. If you want to try it that way. Do you need a little more? Or you got it?
Yeah, I'll get a little more.
Not bad. I like the rosé better with the grilled cheese.
Yeah, the trick is, so the Italians say about food and wine pairing, do you want to try a little more?
Sure.
I can't talk and do anything else at the same time. I get too sidetracked. Do you have a little more sauce? You can have the butter sauce or I have the tomato as well. Butter you need here. So the Italians say of food and wine pairing, if you have good food, good wine, and good company, it's going to be a good pairing. But there are good pairings, and then there are better pairings, and then there are pairings that are, they just like blow your mind. So, you know, what we're going for is hitting consistently the better. So, you know, the chicken with butter sauce and the Riesling was a better pairing, and the rosé with the butter sauce was a good pairing. It's not terrible, and there aren't that many really terrible pairings out there, although we can go back with some of the lighter things and do them with the heavier reds and see if they stand up to them or not. But a lot of times you'll have something that's just okay, and then you don't even realize that it's good, but it's not that good until you have something that's really, really good, which is why I wanted to go back and forth this way for the pairings. I'm going to test you guys afterwards. If somebody comes in and says, this is what I'm eating, what wine should I choose? You'll have a go-to.
Yeah. It was really good with the Riesling.
The butter sauce?
The other one, the spicy one.
With
the tomatoes.
Yeah. And that's actually the for a dry Riesling, a lot of people will pair like a light fish or a chicken or a pork tenderloin with a very light, especially in the summertime, like a pico de gallo style sauce. Something maybe with a little bit of bite to it and so forth. I also brought, if anybody wants to be super rogue, I brought just Tabasco peppers straight out of the garden, spicy ones. So try that. I think it's probably going to be a little rough going with all of the wines because of the level of acidity. Spicy, the best match for it is sweet. So try it and see, you know, how, but the it's like adding gasoline to a fire, the acid with the spicy. The sugar in a sweeter wine will neutralize that. So what happens is it'll cut through the sugar of the sweet wine, but it'll also cut through the acid of the spice tone, the capsaicin or whatever from peppers of the spicy food.
If I don't use for tonight, then I can
still go over here. Yes, yeah, it's butter on top of butter. And that's a pairing of likes, which can work really well, but you have to really like that flavor component. You know, putting a creamy wine with a buttery sauce. So, you know, this would be, for example, Thanksgiving dinner. We had chicken with a basic white wine gravy, but that's exactly how I make my gravy for Thanksgiving with the turkey drippings. So if you were trying to decide between a dry Riesling or a Chardonnay for the Thanksgiving table, that gives you an illustration of what those pairings are going to look like when you're actually eating the turkey with the gravy and everything else. Are you suffering over there?
Those puppies got spicy.
Yeah.
We were just talking about, you know, how some of the restaurants have habanero that
yes.
You finish them, they give you something.
They give you something free, yeah.
And they take a picture.
I feel like that's never, it's just never a good idea.
Bread, you might need bread. Right? Bread for now.
Yeah.
Spicy.
Yeah. Sorry. I'm like, good idea. And then it's like,
I have it over here.
All right, so drink them or dump them.
And now wait for somebody else to
really well.
Yeah. And it's funny, you know, sometimes you want to drink wine on a Wednesday night, but you don't necessarily want to cook a 5-course meal. And so, you know, what goes with buttered popcorn? What do you want to smuggle into the movies? What goes with grilled cheese? What goes with, you know, delivery pizza? Those are, I think, more legitimate questions for a lot of people than what goes with the steak that I have at Ruth's Chris Steakhouse or so forth and so on. It's more, you know, how do I make my children's leftover macaroni and cheese with ketchup on it. What's going to pair well with that so that I can eat it after they